Combining some move with PNR gets you some amazing ways for card advantage and finding lethal against your opponents with Naya Exile. Hey Dragonauts, Astros Lane here, tapping out to talk about Naya Exile. And just like I'm tapping out, you should tap that subscribe button to stay updated on all the new standard decks for the Lost Caverns of Ixalan meta. And with that, let's get talking about what makes this Naya Exile deck so amazing. And that starts off with one key card. You're already going to see right off the bat, Pia Nalar, 2 mana, 2-3, great stats. All your Thopters have haste, and whenever you play a land or cast a spell from Exile, you get to make a Thopter. Making an army of Thopters, progressing with flying, and attacking right away, delivering fast damage to the opponent is the key to this deck's, lethal advantage and power overall. But what we're going to really do to push that is actually combine that type of effect with Samut, the Vizier of Naktamun. Samut is coming in as a 2-3, 3 mana with first strike vigilance and haste and a key ability we want to take advantage of. Whenever creature you control deals combat damage to a player, if it entered the battlefield this turn, draw a card. So you pair that with all your Thopters from PNLR, and that is a ton of card draw you're about to get. Now, card draw, fast damage, great engine to have in. We need to make those Thopters though. To get that going, we are running a set of cards to fuel in the exile effects. That's coming in with Questing Druid as the Seek the Beast instant. We're running some Wren's Resolves to exile more cards, and even taking advantage of a new card from Lost Caverns of Ixalan, Inti, the Senseless Shawl of the Sun, a 2 mana 2-2. Whenever you attack, discard a card. If you do, a creature is going to get +1/+1 trample until end of turn, and whenever you discard one or more cards, you can exile the top part of your library and play that until the end step. Playing that card from exile means another Thopter from Pia, which is what we want. But that's not the only way we're going to win, right? We need a few other token advantages. Well, Nimpakal, the Thousandth Moon, is also going to be an advantage here. With all those non-gnome creatures we're attacking with, you know, our Thopters, Nimpakal is going to grow and grow and also create more attacking creatures, which when the gnomes come in on the trigger from a Nim, those gnomes deal some damage, some Moon is also going to trigger. So your Thopters are going to hit in, your Nim tokens are going to hit in, you're keeping your handful of cards. What is that going to get you? That is going to get you more value in your removal package, where Witchstalker Frenzy is going to be a great piece to take down any annoying blockers or flyers or just things you don't want to deal with on the opponent's side of the board. Might also let you grab in a Get Lost here. Good, amazing removal piece on this. It cleans up a creature, an enchantment, or a planeswalker. The map tokens you don't care about, but it gets rid of something in your way. You may also be able to draw into a couple cards we've got here, the Monastery Swift Spear and the Kimono Faces Kakazin. The big thing of running Monastery Swift Spear and Kimono Faces Kakazin in this build is the ability of the haste from the Swift Spear that pairs well with what we're doing with Samut to draw that card. We are playing a lot of non-creatures, so that prowess is going to be a great. And Kimono Faces Kakazin along the same line. While it does buff our board a little bit on the creature that comes into play, this comes in with haste. That is an enter the battlefield. That's a card draw off Samut, and we are playing an aggro deck. Now, the last card I love talking about in this deck, and honestly, it's probably two, but I'll talk about my favorite first, is the Bonehorde Dracusaur. Now, while we are a low-curve aggressive deck, the Dracusaur is a great one of inclusion. If you draw it, it's amazing. If you don't, well, that's fine. This thing is a 5-mana, 5-5 flying first striker, and it pays into that exile effect. You're going to exile cards from the top, which gives you a more fuel for Pia, and that is ultimately what you want. If the game isn't over already, the Dracusaur is going to push it to the end. We're going to end that cleanup here with the Pollen Shield Hare. Your creature tokens get +1/+1, and it's a great effect to use from casting an adventure card from exile, getting that hair raising ability to save a creature or push in some lethal damage. When we get into the sideboard really quick, a few select options here. Elspeth's Might can come in against those aggro matchups, taking down attackers from the opponent, dealing 3 damage. We've got Cutzul's Flanker. Sorry, the Flanker is great against control matchups coming in to if your board gets wiped with all those Thopters. Cutzul is going to get huge because of that +1/+1 for each creature that left the battlefield. Or you can use it for exiling a graveyard. Emperor, just honestly, great way for extra removal against mid-range decks or aggro. Lithob Manic Barrage for any annoying Planeswalkers, Soldier decks, or Haughty Djinns. Braids for annoying artifacts because Jameel's been kicking around a little bit and we need a way to stop Jameel. Laron coming in for those enchantment or artifacts removal too. And lastly, the extra Witchstalker's Frenzy for aggro matchups. Dragonauts, this is Naya Exile with Samoon and Pia. Please enjoy the game. I kind of like this, actually. We're going to look like mono red at the start. But it's going to get really cool really quick here. I'm doing this for the prowess trigger. I like prowess. Yes, I do. We like prowess. How about you? Oh, cool. Copper Gorge into some moots. Hey, what's going on, Calper? Happy Sunday, but good to see you. How you doing tonight? My only thought here is that they might have the herd migration. Hey, Questing Druid's a nice little pull-off here. So they do have their herd migration. Grabbing the forest, this may mean turn 3 Topiary Stomper. Honestly, that's fine. It does potentially mean that the opponent is going to hit me with a Sunfall next turn. But I think in that instance, I'm just attacking him. And then passing the turn. And we're going to Questing Druid on end step if they do Sunfall. Boros Humans to Mythic, Modified and Boros. Heck yeah, Calper, that's awesome. Way to go. All right, getting another land. Sure. I'm going to play tap, so they can't hit me with Leyline Binding because they're missing a land still. I, however, am going to get a very nice turn. We're going to go in for Swifty. I'm going to lose this if I don't play. So I'm going to play in this creature. And I'm going to set up my exile on the next turn. So we got Pia, which is great for tokens. And we get to draw a card. Sweet. So even if they Sunfall, we've just got lethal. Excellent. JS, what's going on, friend? How you doing tonight? Welcome in. Happy Sunday, friend. Yeah, so even if they do Sunfall here, we're just set. I personally don't see what the opponent takes away from here. Like, Archangel of Wrath kinda can help. The play into Invasion is Zendikar, sure, that's fine. That allows both Stompers to attack, but frankly, I can just double block both. So that's fine. Briefcase is a blocker, sure. End of day or end of diamond? I'm not sure, Calper. Do I just let that flip? I think I just let that flip. They're at 2. I'm not really worried. Like, that's fine. All I have to do is play in Pia here. And I can just win with Thopters. Like, that looks pretty good to me. My Thopters win this game. And I still have a Torch to the Tower, so one. Game 2 against this particular opponent. So, Scytheclaw Raptor, very handy against Domain. You know, flashing in and everything like that with the Leyline Binding. So, Scytheclaw Raptor is quite good. I already have the Destroy Evil, so I'm happy on that end. I want to leave in the flanker in case we do hit a Sunfall. I think the Warcraftings are going to get cut. I'll leave in Samut. We'll cut a Torch the Tower. And I think Sushi is going to get cut here. Lurks, no worries, Phoenix and Jerry, look, friend. We'll be here when you get back. And I think that's the substitution. We're going to kind of... All right. Hey, what's going on, Dell? How you doing? Virtue, I'm going to keep. It's better to play Get Lost instead of Destroy Evils? Ooh, great question. Personally, I still like Destroy Evil. But you could potentially play either. You could definitely play either. Let's go ahead and bring in that Virtue. And I'm going to work on playing in the Scytheclaw Raptor here. They're definitely holding up a Leyland button, so let's punish them on holding it up. And we're going to attack for two. Ah, see, we were right about the Leyland button. Look how we forced out their turn, though. How that works, isn't it? Let's go ahead and get in a Wren's Resolve here. Play in that land and attack for two. Pass the turn. Yeah, Miguel, how is your Sunday going, friend? How you doing tonight? Ooh, all right. Let's go ahead and flash in another 2/2 here. Now, in the off chance that the opponent does happen to have another Leyline Binding, I'm gonna opt for the Wren's Resolve. We're gonna go for our Sorcery Speed Wren's Resolve first. And let's see an Invasion of Gobakon from hand. And see, maybe we force out a Leyline Binding to hit a 2/2. Watching the new set? Awesome, glad to hear. Hopefully you're enjoying the new set so far. So, we see double Sunfall, Knockout Blow, Leyline Binding, Atraxa. To me, the Knockout Blow could be very annoying, so let's go ahead and get rid of the Knockout Blow. And we're gonna work to clear our Invasion of Gobakon. Forcing out a Leyline Binding from the opponent's hand. I am very, very okay with Binding's gone, they're missing lands, all we see is a Sunfall. I am perfectly fine with what's going on. Let's just jam in a Virtue of Loyalty here. We'll play in the Corpollution Force from our hand and attack 2 to face, which is 4 total, putting them to 12. Notice how I'm holding back the Pia ring. Hey, what's going on, Locke? How you doing tonight? Welcome in, friend. The third binding from the opponent. Sure. That's perfectly fine with me. Hey, what's going on, Caleb? Happy Sunday. How you doing tonight? Hope you and Locke are both doing good, friends. It's a pleasure to have you in. Come for your standard fix. I'm happy to deliver. Now, if the opponent does hit a land off the top to cast in Sunfall, I want to have up my flanker. So I have to be careful how I do this. But I think I'm only going to attack in for 2 here. And they could just depop. So let's hold back. Alright, so the opponent is going to depopulate here. We're going to let that resolve. And do you remember when I was talking about that Kazul's flanker? Now suddenly we have 7 power on the board. And we're gonna go ahead, bring in Pia Nalar here, bring in the Virtue, get in the Thopter, and poke in for as much damage as we can before that Sunfall gets active. And we're going to force the opponent here. Have the sun, have the untapped land for the Sunfall. Or not. And we take game two. Grab the play here. Yeah, into Questing Druid. I can play the Druid down. I can't exile. We can't get a Samud after a Pia, though. I can also do a Druid after a Samud. I don't mind. Actually, that makes it 2/2/2s attacking on turn three. And getting a card draw off Samud. That part is nice. One for human first. My other option is I hold back Pia and I play out Pia. Turn two here. Soldiers. Alright, both soldiers, that's a difference. Okay, Pia's fine here. Pia trades very effective against soldiers here. 2-3 against a 2-1 stops them from attacking in. I love flooding him with 22 land deck. Yeah, seriously. I wouldn't go lower than 22 lands. 22 is probably fine, honestly. Turn two Valiant Veteran's annoying. It's fine. Honestly, take three. Honestly, that's fine. 2/2 down, Battlefield Forge Summon Pass. Samut. Only attack with Samut. Draw card. Okay. Prairie, not bad. Stalker is up next turn, so we can like maybe Questing Druid. Running 24 is probably ideal. Yeah. 24 is like we could. But we see a lot of cards. Opponent has Brutal Cathar in hand. If they bring down Cathar, they hit Samut. Samut's what gives me better trades here. If they let Pia live, I can go Questing Druid, exile, find two cards. And like hold up a Witchstalker's Frenzy to lead in my turn for Thopters to push in more damage and then deal with the Cathar. So, another veteran. That's fine. Do I just want to take the 7 here? It's tempting. Like, actually tempting. Yeah. Yeah, we'll take the 7. That's fine. I'll put a pen. Battlefield Forge, two legendaries. I have Frenzy and a Gonjo up. I maybe could have done Restless Prairian. I could have done Restless Prairie and then held up a Gonjo and Frenzy here. I got third in the challenge, more human-y, but still interesting. I actually did not jump. No, I saw the Golgari decks. It looked interesting. The two Golgari mid-range. I saw one Golgari Cauldron, but there was no Agatha's Cauldron in there. Oop. Take out the Valiant Veteran here. Double block, first strike kills the Valiant, and then the crewman dies to the Pia. Hold back the Frenzy. Okay. Questing Druid on their end step. 34 creatures, 4 NT, 4 land, 22. Cathar? Sure.
Prairie Swifty. Pull back Pia. Go for three. Could have drawn more of the Sokensen. But I don't want to get too greedy at the moment. Not yet. But soon. Announcement's fine. I'm liking how this is playing out against soldiers. This is really good, actually. We can just go ahead and exile two cards now. Krauss at this point doesn't matter. What matters is seeing the top two cards to trigger Thopter's Rupia. And there's game one. It's nice, nice, nice. Okay. Okay, okay, okay. Okay. This is... We doing things. We doing things. And when I don't misplay... when I don't misplay, it's amazing how great of a magic player I can be. Okay, actually, Witchstalker's Frenzy... really good in this match. Roron? Against aggro, yeah, I don't care for Bone Horde against aggro. I like Bone Horde just as my one of my index to start, but then I'll always take it out if I need to. If I need to against control, like against aggro decks. How about Roron answers the wedding announcement? Maybe it's cut the get loss, bring in Smite. Bring in two Lorans, go down one in Nim, cut the hair. Because these are just going to be one mana removals and then a creature that develops against their wedding announcement. Lithomantic actually is really good too, though. Also can't be countered, so maybe it's just Witchstalker's Frenzy, hold a Lithomantic. Cut one Ren's Resolve. Caught one questing druid. Try that. Get a 2-2, have an Anemba call set up or Samoot. We just have giant creatures ready on turn 3 with Samoot. So if we hit the third land, Samoot can come down in turn 3. We could potentially hit two cards with Samoot connecting, can mono hit. That also buffs questing druid to be up to 3-3 on turn 3. And we have an Anemba call follow up with the Samoot. To just start making the 1-1s for more draw, outpacing the opponent card advantage. This is dependent on the third land, but we're on the draw. I'm gonna keep. This is like almost an ideal hand. Like really freaking close. Okay, now it's an ideal hand. Not misplay this time. Play on the Kamano. No misplay this time. Play, come on. Okay. Holding up Resolute? That's fine. We have the Lithomantic. Let me just have a 2-2 Questing Druid here. You have Resolute, you're going to flash in. I'm going to have a 2-2 Druid. Beats your 1-1s. Way they make this, they wouldn't make disappear our questing druid, would they? Oh, they would. You don't have any creatures. Protected Negotiator doesn't work. Well, Dragonaunt, that's Nia Exile. Thank you so much for watching, and as always, keep believing. I'll catch you next time.